Welcome to Data Skeptic. Data Skeptic brings you discussions about how data is changing our world. Our interviews are conversations with thought leaders in topics like data science, machine learning, and artificial intelligence.
In the first half of this episode, I've got an interview with Steve Guggenheimer, CVP of Artificial Intelligence at Microsoft. We discuss AI in industry, what's hype and what's really going on. After that, you'll hear from Carlos Pessoa, where we discuss a few interesting AI-related projects he's worked on, including an intelligent kiosk that I got to interact with when I was at Microsoft Build a few weeks ago, where I recorded these interviews. Lastly, thanks to our sponsor, thegreatcoursesplus.com/data.
My name's Steve Guggenheimer. I work at Microsoft, and I work on our artificial intelligence across the company and across the industry with customers and partners. Most of what I spend my time on is sort of how do companies think about, you know, how did we get, where are we? Like, because the hype is so high today. So how do you balance out the, you know, where are we in the hype cycle? And then what should we do? And then sort of what are the things that are available for us to work with? And that's generally the conversation. It sort of starts with a little bit of a, even though we've worked on AI for a long time, you know, A, where are we? And B, why is it such a hot topic today? And then sort of what is Microsoft doing in this space? From sort of building platforms for developers to trying to infuse it into our own products to actually how do we use it to help run the company?
Yeah.
That ends up being a pretty helpful conversation for a lot of other company executives who don't live and breathe it, but because it's such a hot topic, they want to know how to play.
AI is certainly a big topic. I wouldn't be comfortable investing in any company that wasn't thinking, what's our AI strategy right now? Even if the answers hold off for certain industries maybe, but around the excitement, how do you tell people what's real and cut through some of the hype?
The conversation on AI is really around sort of why is it real today and how should people think about it? And I think for the why it's real today, you know, even though AI's been around for 20 plus years, when I came out of university, my roommate in college was a Lisp programmer. The combination of sort of the growth of the cloud, which means having access to essentially compute and storage and networking at scale for any developer anywhere on the planet, we just didn't have that before. And so we had us or Google or Amazon, that cloud sort of gives us the ability to sort of work at scale. The second is the growth of data, and whether it's human-generated or device-generated, a lot of conversation there. And the third, frankly, is research, fundamental research that's sort of taking what was hard to do and sort of very much in the science category and turning it into a set of tools that developers can use. And so whether it's cognitive services or conversational interfaces or the machine learning tools that are being built, that set of tools combined with the data at scale and then the ability to access compute and storage at scale means any developer sort of anywhere on the planet can start to work with AI. That said, it's still early. The platforms are all evolving. You know, there's a few fundamental players in the industry, but that figuring out where to focus and what to do is a place where a lot of companies need help. And then from a data perspective, sort of, while we can work with data and we have data at scale, it's still a mess for the most part. And the fundamentals are just coming into place today. And so with most companies, you know, we have a conversation on getting comfortable with cognitive services, not all of them, but pick an area, whether it's computer vision and image recognition or, you know, natural language processing and speech. Pick a cognitive service, decide whether you want to think about conversational interfaces or not, and start to play with that relative to infusing an existing app that you have. And then on the data side, pick an area where you have unique data, figure out what type of insight you're after, and then go work to apply that into a specific area. And then to the extent you really think you have the capability to stitch things together, multiple data sets, multiple tools, and build an end-to-end solution, then let's have that conversation.
So where do those conversations start? Do enterprise companies know that they need to search for AI and approach you for help, or do you know the tools and see the opportunities and have to make it clear that there's a fundamental shift people need to take advantage of?
Most companies want to know more about AI. It's just, and they feel like, hey, I don't want to be left behind. And so we start with that sort of fundamental why AI today and then bridge through what we're doing as a company. But there's never been sort of a topic in my mind that's generated this much combination of interest and hype this early in the process where everybody wants to know about it, yet it's not something that everybody can do deeply yet.
So what are they missing? What do they need to most know?
I think it's the pace of where to spend your energy. It's too early to do everything with AI, even though you can imagine, anything you can imagine you can sort of have a conversation on, but it's too late to do nothing. So finding the right place to focus and figuring out where to spend your energy as a team, you find a lot of gaps between we'll say the executives who have seen television commercials or read articles that, you know, on how transformational AI will be, to the, you know, potentially the IT shop or the developers who have some sense for where things are, and trying to figure out the right place to spend their energy. It's been important, and frankly, a lot of them want to know what we're doing. You know, and that ends up being 2/3 to 1/2 of the conversation.
So the pure software development lifecycle has matured quite a bit. The way we build software, we've learned a lot. Everyone has, you know, and the tooling is there, change management, all these things. And you can probably sketch out with the right scrum and all that, a pretty long-term plan for what you build and how you do features. Software's mature in design. AI, even when there's tools available and cognitive services, there's always a research component, an unknown to it. You can't promise an F1 score before you get going. How do you have to change the paradigm of how you look at scoping and where you invest your time in light of, you know, the uncertainties around the process?
No, and I think, I would say well put, the challenge with a lot of AI projects today is you don't hire sort of the architect and the dev and the tester and instead of the scrum and say, let's go build it, because you don't know when you're going to hit your milestones. And in fact, for us, when we work on solutions, our teams are half researchers and half developers. I'll take a classic example. We've sort of built a virtual agent to help us with customer care. So if you went to Microsoft.com and you were looking for help, you know, in a chat session, there's a virtual agent sitting in the front of that. If you want to build a virtual agent, you can get the cognitive service for language understanding. You can build the bot front end. But programming the dialogues gets to be incredibly tedious depending on how many you have. So if you said, hey, if you want to build a simple virtual agent that says what time does Microsoft open, what time does it close, what's the dress code, where are you located, super easy. If you're trying to answer or have a conversation that's multiple turn, I can't log on to my computer. Okay, you can't log on to Windows, Office, or Skype. I can't log on to Windows. Okay, Windows 7, 8, or 10. Okay, I can't log on to Windows 10. Okay, did you try this? Yes. Did it work? No. That multiple turn, as soon as you add, you know, even a few intents, much less a couple thousand intents, times multiple turns, the number of dialogue trees you're working on is millions or hundreds of millions. You can't program that. So this notion that I'm going to sort of set up a project plan and go work, you know, we had to ingest a year's worth of chat logs, figure out the intents and entities, create a conversational agent, test it out, build the tooling to figure out where we're going. But the original project, there was no plan for it. It was a research project. And so whether it's a 3-month project or a 6-month project, when you go into a new domain, if you pick a different use case, take ambient. They showed a scenario in a room today with a speaker sitting in the middle and people talking and disambiguation of voice. And okay, that's a multi-year research project. Once you get to the point that you've done enough of it, then you can start to have an idea. I would say the good news today is we've taken years worth of research projects. So if you take computer vision, it's its own area of science, been at it for years. Yeah. If you take the natural language processing, I've been doing, you know, voice activation demos since like 2000, you know, speech recognition demos, Petey the Parrot.
The difference is they're working now.
But what you see now is, what you see is that in that cognitive toolkit, you start to see a normalization. Mm-hmm. Here's a set of APIs that now look similar, and a set of documentation that's starting to look similar, and sample code that's starting to look similar. We're starting to take these areas that have primarily been research and building a layer now where developers can begin to work with us. So on one hand, if I want to go build that virtual agent to handle thousands of intents and do the rest, I need researchers and developers. If I just want to take computer vision, I want to build a system that allows me to detect anomalies in a manufacturing system, the Jabil, you can do that. You know, as a developer, I can take a singular cognitive service, I can use it. If I have a set of data, it starts to feel like part of a development life cycle. If I want to sort of do something new from scratch, I want to take computer vision and a drone and I want to go look at power lines, you know, it depends on what you're trying to do. That's why I always start with companies on the, let's pick something you're already doing. Sometimes we'll show a video from Uber where they use face recognition to recognize the driver and authenticate the driver. Reasonably simple, it fits into their natural workflow. Yeah. Let's start with a workflow you have. Let's think about how, whether a conversational interface or something unique with data or something with a cognitive service can help you infuse that and make it a little, you know, smarter or more natural. And then we'll go from there. As opposed to, let's build the customer care virtual agent that does voice and chat systems from scratch, and we've never done this before. Or let's go build an in-room scenario that recognizes people and objects and voice. You know, there's patterns in AI, ambience a pattern, virtual agents are patterns, AI assisting humans. So let's go pick something that maps and go from there. And that works pretty well.
Makes sense. So I'm very curious about that team design you described, half developers, half researchers. Can you tell me more about how that collaboration develops?
We're still developing it, obviously. Sure, I'm laughing because it's a lot of learning for us. If I come back to that customer care example, if you want to sort of ingest a year's worth of chat logs and be able to find intents and entities, you need people who are up to speed on machine reading and comprehension. And it turns out the researchers that know that area are deep, very good at it. And so our team has some of those folks in it. If we get to the point where we say, hey, we want to repeat this, and maybe we're going to go work in Europe, so maybe we start need to think about GDPR compliance. If I ask the researchers about GDPR compliance, I'm going to get a blank stare.
Right.
If I ask the developers about where we are on the squad leaderboard relative to machine reading and comprehension, I'm going to get a blank stare. So what we've had to do is bring the two worlds together and find the right way to sort of have everybody interact. In the beginning, it's almost all research, very little developer. As soon as you say, hey, here's a pattern that we think is somewhat repeatable, and we think it could be a solution or it could be an area of interest, then you start to mix in sort of developers that come from, whether it's the Azure group or the Office group, and have some of the fundamentals in place. And then you have to have enough flexibility in the system that we can keep updating the MRC tools, because they're still moving quickly. And at the same time, have enough sort of consistency in what we're building that we can meet the scale of multiple customers, start to meet different regulation and compliance areas. Even now, we're starting to look at sort of the second generation of the platform because most of the things in the beginning are hand-coded and making it more of a traditional platform. But it's a real interesting scenario, I don't want to say who's in charge, but sort of who leads which areas, and then how do you mix traditional program management into that so you actually have a sort of a feature list, and how do you decide which features are more important, sort of getting ahead in sort of the next generation of MRC or landing that GDPR compliance. It's a very interesting dynamic, and I think we're all learning how to work with it.
Definitely. That heuristic you gave really stood out for me to try when it comes to how do we apply AI to our business.
Yep.
Do what you're already doing.
Right.
It'd be easy to do some gimmicky thing. And
right.
What are we going for then when we're going after a core issue? Is it, in general, the trends you see from working with clients, does it tend to be take a human out of the loop to speed up a process?
Yep.
What are the gains businesses should be seeking?
I think in terms of gains, most companies will tell you they want to do both. If you can help me save my bottom line, there's a certain goodness to that. But if you help me increase top line, there's more goodness to that.
Right.
And so that's just a general on that. We're not overly specific yet, I'll say that, because we're, again, being early in the process. We can give examples from ourselves, like customer care. I know we are handling 5 million sessions a month using the virtual agent. It increases customer sat, it increases our agent sat. So I can give specifics on certain things. Right now, what we do is try and help people with the patterns. Like, where should we apply this, and then how does that map to your business? So there's four patterns I generally see. There is this notion of a virtual agent, whether it's internally facing. Let me create an agent for HR to answer HR questions, mm-hmm. or here's an agent to answer legal questions, or externally facing. Here's an agent to help with customer care or be proactive. That's a pattern. Does that pattern help in your business? Does it fit? A second pattern is sort of this notion of ambient computing, tracking people and objects in space. So tracking people, the simplest example is, can I use face recognition to get entry into a building? Can I tell when people came in, fire drill, can I tell if everybody got out? Most advanced, or one that's very popular, retail. Can I tell when somebody walks into a store? Can I tell when they pick things up? Can I tell when they put them back? Can I tell if they've been put back in the wrong place? Shrinkage issue. Can I do checkout automatically? Amazon started a phase of this in a very sort of controlled environment. Most traditional retailers don't get the opportunity to start from scratch.
Right.
And so that ambient is a pattern, a lot of interest in that. And so that might be a place we spend energy. AI assisting professionals. Can I help with forecasting, the financial the financial team inside of a company? Can we help marketing people do marketing better? Healthcare, can we think about radiomics or genomics? Can you use AI to assist humans in whatever endeavor they're doing? And the last one is autonomous systems. People think of self-driving cars, but it turns out, can we use AI relative to managing the network? So quality of service for Azure, for example, or mm-hmm. routing for Azure. So what's the pattern that's interesting to you as a company? What are the horizontal services you use to run the company, and let's pick one.
To wind up, I'm wondering if you could share some advice for a specific type of listener I'm aware of who's out there.
Okay.
Someone who's at a company, there's some buzz about AI, but maybe they're not doing anything yet,
yep.
and they want to be the hero developer to come in and say, here's where I think the opportunities are.
Right.
What should they be exploring and learning about, given that, who knows what their industry might need?
Well, I always break it into three things. Mm-hmm. Look, learning a little bit about cognitive services. So how do you replicate human cognition, the ability to hear, the ability to see, the ability to speak? Is there one of those attributes that you can infuse into your existing scenarios that might make sense. Mm-hmm. And that's a thought process you should look at. You should go learn about cognitive services. So that's one. Second thing is, conversations, a front-end experience is likely where we'll go. So if we go through, we've gone from mouse and keyboard to hyperlinks with the internet, still mouse and keyboard, but hyperlinks to touch, to gestures. I'm pretty sure, and most people think, conversation will be the next UI model. Mm-hmm. Long tail of apps is getting old. How do I, whatever tool I'm sitting in, I don't care if, you know, Facebook Messenger or Slack or Skype, how do I be able to ask questions or have a conversation? So a second thing to do is go look at conversational interfaces. If there's an opportunity to take some processes you have and add a virtual agent or conversation flow into that, that's the second thing to look at, because that's a direction. The third is that data area. You know, where do you have unique data? Not to resell right away. People say, oh, I've got this data, I think I can make a lot of money on it. Look, it's hard to make money on data.
Yeah.
Unless your company's set up to do that, let's pause for a moment on that. How can you use potentially the data that you have to provide some unique insight that allow you to run the company better? And then the third thing is look for horizontal processes, whether it's how you do forecasting as a company, whether it's how you manage your supply chain, whether it's how you do manufacturing, whether it's how you run customer care, whether it's how you do onboarding for new employees. Look for these horizontal processes where you have a decent amount of data, where maybe you want to stitch together some of these processes to create an AI solution or framework that allows you to do something differently.
Well, thanks so much again for joining me today.
Hey everybody, the Data Skeptic podcast really exists to give me an excuse to personally dig into topics I'm fascinated by. I'm a lifelong learner and I get information from lots of sources, and one of my favorite ways to learn is with The Great Courses Plus. Recently I went through the course Mathematical Decision Making, Predictive Models, and Optimization. I wanted to check it out and see if it would be a good way to introduce the topics to people, and the answer is yes. It covers time series, data mining. It'll get you started with linear algebra if you don't have the background in it. We move on to Bayesian analysis, nonlinear models, Markov models, and MCMC. Cap it all off with a review of stochastic optimization, and you'll be ready to tackling problems of your own. This is a perfect course for data skeptic listeners to get started with, or choose from any of the thousands of lectures they have. There's tons of stuff right up my alley, and I'm sure you're going to find a lot of things for yourself as well. Now, with The Great Courses Plus, you'll get unlimited access to stream their entire library. Learn from engaging professors and experts about any topic that interests you. Math, engineering, astronomy, history, computer science. They'll even teach you how to play chess or draw. We know you'll love The Great Courses Plus too. And so for a limited time, they're offering Data Skeptic listeners a very special offer. You're going to get 1 month of free unlimited access to all their lectures. That's a really generous intro period. Now to get that free month, head to thegreatcoursesplus.com/data. One more time, that's thegreatcoursesplus.com/data.
Okay, I'm Carlos Pessoa. I have been at Microsoft for about 16 and a half years. And during this time, I have worked in many different teams. And in the last 2.5 to 3 years or so, I have been working in the AI platform group, helping showcase the potential of our AI technologies.
Very neat. Tell me more about what the AI platform includes.
The AI platform includes things like cognitive services, for example. These are off-the-shelf, ready-to-be-used APIs that any developer without an AI background can go and consume and get a lot of rich insights from rich data. Mm-hmm. This can be audio, it can be text, it can be pictures, videos, and so on. It includes Azure Machine Learning, for example, that allows you to create custom models and very complex systems that can provide insights from your custom data and your custom scenarios. Mm-hmm. It includes things like Windows ML that allows you to load AI modules inside of your own app in Windows and run everything offline. The platform includes all these things and things like AI tools for Visual Studio that allows you to integrate with models directly in Visual Studio and get helper classes that allows you to, like as a developer, to work with them more easily. Mm-hmm. So the AI platform covers all these different things, and there is common functionality between them that the team is responsible for. And in my particular role, I work with the teams building these stacks to try to showcase them by connecting some different pieces in an end-to-end story so that developers can see an example, customers can see what's possible, It's kind of like a blueprint. Mm-hmm. And some of the stuff I built ends up in an app that we have that the field uses and the product teams use and some companies use. That app's called the Intelligent Kiosk. And it's a collection of about 30 some different AI demos that keeps on growing.
Yeah.
And the idea there is that they are autonomous. They use the web camera, so they detect when people approach the screen, and then they start providing insights right on your face,
right.
or based on the scene in front of you, like right there where you are. And the idea there is, can we use AI to drive a demo that is autonomous and that can show the tech without necessarily having a person there and having you click buttons and so
on. Yeah.
So it turned out to be very natural and a very easy way for teams in conferences and when engaging with customers. Mm-hmm. There is also an open source version of that on GitHub. Another part is coming to conferences like here at Build and engaging with folks, presenting, meeting with customers and going through the tech and helping the teams as well, giving them feedback.
I'd love to talk a little bit more about the kiosk and then maybe get into some of those process discussions.
Right.
So my first encounter with it was here at the conference on not even day one, the sign-up day, it was up. I came to get my badge.
That's right.
And there's just this big monitor with some dashboards on it. I'm thinking, what is this?
Yep.
So I go up to it, and immediately my face is bounded, boxed, and there's some metadata around it.
That's right.
Can you describe that user experience for people who didn't get to see it the way I did?
The user experience there, the idea is, what does the computer understand from what's in front of the camera? In that particular case there, it's just a regular RGB camera. There's nothing special. The computer running the app is just a regular laptop. The screen is just a screen. But because it can tap into cognitive services, the computer can now make sense of what that data is. So imagine if that, instead of being here at a conference, this was a kiosk at a hotel that is trying to provide guidance about the city, like what to go see, what to do, and so on. So the typical kiosk, you're going to get this generic experience where you walk up to, it might have a list of everything, and then you have to browse a map and find your way around and so on, and get recommendations. Imagine now if there was a human there, and then they see you approaching that kiosk, and then they ask, you might be interested in finding things, and they see it's a family. It's like a woman, a spouse, and kids.
So how do they see that? How does the system know?
Well, if it was, let's say it was a human for now. Let's say this was a human-operated kiosk for guidance.
Gotcha.
They see it's a family, then they could just maybe tailor the suggestions for what to do in the city.
Yep.
They say, you know, today's a nice day. It's sunny. You are a family. Close to us here, there's a zoo. That might be a good thing for you to go see. Maybe go check out the big Ferris wheel that we have. It's a good activity for family or the aquarium and so on. On the other hand, if it's a single person or a young couple, they might have a different suggestion for them. So that's a human. So now a kiosk, if it doesn't have a camera, there's no way they could do that. It would be always this generic list of all the things.
Yep.
Now with that kiosk, if that kiosk has a camera and can see what's there, that experience can be closer to what a human would be. The camera can see that, hey, I see a face here that looks like a woman. Another face looks like another adult. I see two young kids in here as well. Maybe this is a good place to promote some family-oriented suggestions. And the same for like elderly folks, if there are elderly folks in there. So that is an example of the idea there is to kind of inspire the people seeing these things that say, hey, the computer through this technology can get a lot of insights about what's the crowd in front of it. So you can imagine, like I gave an example of this kiosk in a hotel. If this was an ATM in a bank, you're not going to use that camera for security because it's just an RGB camera, but you could use that camera to maybe tailor the UI. So it's one thing to have a UI for like a young person versus a very elderly person. So maybe for the elderly, you might make it simpler with bigger fonts. Maybe for the younger one, you might promote the Twitter or the Facebook group or something that might be closer associated with people in that age group.
Or personalized to the user, maybe.
Yes,
you know,
you could personalize. You could also personalize for them.
Don't authenticate, but personalize.
Personalize, yes. And that is an example for like an art studio or like a museum where it's not about security, it's about personalization.
Yeah, yeah.
So imagine you go to like an art display and they see like you look like 17 It's very different than maybe someone who is in a very different age group. Yes. And then they could maybe tailor, have this smart experience based on the people who are there. And that's just touching the surface on age, right? And gender. If you go to emotion and analyze the expression of the people, now you can like even take this to another level. Let's say this is a toy in a house and it's experienced engagement with a person on the other end. It can use that as a signal to try to adjust how the conversation goes. And then if you're trying to like happy them up, you can maybe do a joke and then see how they react. Mm-hmm. If they look sad, you can maybe try to like cope with that and then socialize a little bit with them. And also because these APIs allow you to capture some characteristics of the face, you can use things like the shape of the eyes and nose and the whole jawline to now go into different things, for example, like fashion and things like that, because the computer now seeing that person and understanding a little bit, it's like when you go shopping for glasses, they look at your face and a human being there will probably give you like a good set of suggestions. The computer could approximate that too by seeing the shape of your face. And that's one of the things the Face API provides, is several landmarks about the face, and that can be used for that. So a bunch of these demos, they kind of try to inspire on what is possible there. And then it's up to the companies to put this to practice in a real scenario.
Sure.
Yeah.
Could you tell me a bit more about the specific tools you were using for all those features?
Yes. So that is where it's really neat, because what we did with things like cognitive services, for example, was put them all on the cloud. They are REST APIs. They are one HTTP request away. Just like you go to any browser and go to a page and then get data back.
Yep.
You can go to these APIs and you can pass rich data like text or audio or video or photos. And then it's going to give you back a JSON output with everything it can detect in that picture. So because of the APIs being HTTP APIs and REST endpoints, it means that the amount of tools that you can use, it's pretty much endless. Like you can use any platform, any type of app, as long as it can talk to the internet and make requests, you can pass data and get results back. So in that particular case of the kiosk, I use Visual Studio for the development. It's a universal app for Windows. So it's a Windows 10 app. And that's basically like the only tool I need. And if people go to GitHub and get the source code for the sample for the kiosk, they will see it. All they need is Visual Studio. Then they need to go to the cognitive services and get keys so that they can like send data and get data back. And that's it.
Yep.
So it's very, very flexible. And with the recent effort that we have been doing to allow you to run a lot of these things offline, in that pipeline, we have also been very open. And for example, services like the custom vision that allows you to go and create your own image classifier or your own object detector. When you're done with that, you can keep it in the cloud and then make REST API calls like we just talked about, or you can export it to a model. And now you have this model that, because the way that we export it, we can do it to CoreML, so you can run it iOS natively. We export it to TensorFlow, so you can run it in Android, to ONNX, so you can run it directly on Windows. And recently, we can export it to a container so that you can run it in Linux or Windows. So if you want to do computer vision, for example, you can very easily create these things and keep it in the cloud or go locally and then run it everywhere. It's becoming almost like a plumbing of sorts that connects to anything. It's very generic.
So we talked about a lot of technologies there in a row, and I'm not sure data scientists will know about most of them.
Right.
Visual Studios, people know about it, but it's not necessarily the tool of choice for a lot of data scientists.
That's right.
Xamarin in particular, I think many data scientists won't be aware of.
Yeah.
Could
you
give a rough introduction to these two technologies and how they play into the pipeline?
Yeah, so Visual Studio and Xamarin, they are tools that allow you to create, think of it, the front-end piece of your application. So let's say you're a data scientist and you created a model to, let's say, detect between different currencies. If you train that model with a bunch of labeled data, in the end you get this model that you can pass images and then it can tell you if it is like one of those types that you trained on. Now, how can you consume that model and show it in an app? And that is where Visual Studio and Xamarin, they come into play, because it allows you to create your user interface with your UI to load data from either like a file or from a web camera. It allows you to show the result of your requests to classify data. And they are very easy to use. They provide very rich controls. It's full screen. It runs the web camera. It has all these charts and all that. If you go and look at the code, a lot of that is just consuming built-in controls in the platform. So Visual Studio allows you to almost drag and drop a lot of time. And then if you already have the model built from some other technology that you did, now consuming that model is where they also help. There are wrappers that you can consume, use to call those endpoints in the cloud or to interop with the Windows ML or the equivalent in iOS and Android. Mm-hmm. So they make it very easy to create that top layer on top of the models that you built. And then with that, you get this end-to-end experience.
Yeah, yeah.
As an app developer.
So in hearing about your development of the kiosk,
right.
I'm going to say something. I don't want it to sound like a criticism.
Yes.
But in some sense, it's almost like you didn't do much of anything. Like, all of your work is glue code. You pulled services together, right? And there's a lot of value in glue code. I don't mean to undermine it.
No, that's a very fair point. Sometimes it takes a few days to build one experience.
Yeah, yeah.
Because the model is built. It's done. If I pass data, I get the results back. The UI, depending on what the UI is, it can be as simple as drag and drop things from a list of things that have already been done.
Sure.
And then I click the compile button, and then it might just work, and then I'm done in a day or two with that. And because the kiosk already has created like several demos, it became kind of a shipping vehicle for AI demos. So when one new one comes in, if it kind of falls into the category of similarity in terms of UI to one of the other ones, it's almost like copy and paste and replacing some of the backend calls to a different service so that I show different data, different insights. So it is. And sometimes that is what happens. Like, as engineers, that's what we do. We get things that are very complicated, and then we create layers on top of it to make it super simple so that like people don't have to reinvent the wheel and then go do it. Right. So it's actually like it's not a criticism at all. It's actually like a compliment. It's good. Like if it was complex to do these things, we are doing something wrong. We could improve.
So you've been working with the AI team. So for sure you've absorbed some of their knowledge. You know things about machine learning and whatnot from that experience. But I think the dream that you're describing with cognitive services is that a developer doesn't have to know too much about
exactly.
that.
Exactly, yes.
And maybe the kiosk is a good example of that. Could you talk purely from a developer's point of view?
Yeah.
What was it like to grab these models? How do you know if you trust them?
I know.
Do they work, you know?
It is fascinating, but that is the point, and I'm kind of a living proof of that because I don't have a background in AI or machine learning or any of these areas. Like, I'm a typical developer. At Microsoft, in my 17 or so years that I have been here, the first part was in the .NET framework team. Then the Surface, the original Surface, the Playtable team was the second team. Then Xbox, then Visual Studio. And only until about 2.5 years ago, I moved to the AI area of Microsoft. I hit the ground running like in about a week from the time I started. I already had the first demo that we were creating to work with a local team here, the Seahawks, to help them create an experience that could recognize players in the training facility and help them go through the day in the training camp. At the time, my first task was, can we use face recognition to train a model to recognize those players so that when they walk up to a screen, the screen can greet them by name and already be on that thing that they have to like interact with. I had that demo up and running, and we showed to the Seahawks, and they liked it. And then soon they became a customer, and now it's in deployment there. So they actually, every day, when the Seahawks players go to the facility here, as they check in, there is a screen that by the time they walk and get to it, the screen already knows it's them. And then it greets them by name, and then has four questions for them to quickly answer, and then they move on. And that showed how the main goal for the services, which is to democratize AI and make it so any developer can do AI, how it was a reality.
It's very quickly becoming a commoditized service.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
But your problem was a little more difficult. You didn't, if you had used an off-the-shelf service at the football stadium,
that's right.
Maybe it would say, it's a football player.
Exactly.
And that wasn't
your
need.
Yes, yes.
Can you talk about the customization for the specific implementation that you as a non-data scientist went through?
That's right. Some of the services, they also are customizable. So they have the off-the-shelf, like in the case of the Face API, without providing any label data. You can pass a picture and it's going to tell if it's a male, female, age, gender, the landmarks, mm-hmm. and so on. You can also find if it's a celebrity and those kind of things. But they also have this notion of creating custom models where you can load labeled faces, and there is an API that allows you to send pictures and faces against that model as part of this whole off-the-shelf thing. Mm-hmm. And then it's going to tell with a degree of confidence if it matches one of those faces that you provided previously. So that is one of the things that, even though it's off-the-shelf, there is a degree of customization there that you can do. Recently, they actually expanded those models to go to the million scale, which is impressive. Now you can put a million faces in the model, and then it can still be able to identify folks against that model.
So I also wanted to talk to you about a project you were involved in that was featured on a blog post we're going to link to recently,
uh-huh.
part of the Health Next project, where we're using, or the team you were on was using computer vision to detect skin cancer.
Right.
Can you tell me a little bit about the initiative?
Yes, that project was very interesting because I partner with a data scientist in the team. Mm-hmm. And that is an example where you need a custom model to mm-hmm. do things. But essentially, we got several labeled pictures of moles that had skin cancer uh-huh. and some that did not have. And then we train a model. And once that model is done, we use Xamarin for the app. Mm-hmm. And with Xamarin, you can create that front end that's compatible with different platforms.
So it's a tool for making mobile apps that mobile you took advantage of.
Yeah. The key is that it's multi-platform. Mm-hmm. We use Xamarin to load that model. We converted it to CoreML.
Uh-huh.
So we had this iOS app to take a picture of your mole on your skin. And then completely offline on that device, it can detect how likely it is to be cancer or non-cancer. And the idea there is that for healthcare in particular, there is a lot of privacy concerns with the data privacy. Imagine like if you go to a doctor and the doctor asks you, can I take a picture of this body part uh-huh. to be analyzed? You might have some reservations on that.
Right.
Because you don't know where the picture is going to go to, where it's going
right.
to end up at.
I want my doctor to have it, but I don't want him to forward it to my insurance company necessarily.
Yeah, or maybe go to, like, be sent to the cloud where maybe that provider is not compliant with
Correct, it could be a hack or anything.
Yeah, you never know.
Right.
So it allows scenarios like healthcare to do all that work, that, like, doing that kind of analysis of data directly on that device that the doctor has mm-hmm. without ever saving it to a file. Like, you can do this completely in memory, and the moment you turn off the power, it's gone.
So you've described the process of building the app in Xamarin and using CoreML to deploy it. I don't know that every listener will know about CoreML. Can you describe what it is and how it was useful?
Yeah, so CoreML, and by the way, it's very similar to what the equivalent for Android, TensorFlow, and the similar for Windows ML are. They are layers in the operating system. Think of it like the stack that the operating system provides to allow applications to talk to the hard drive to get data and save data, or to talk to the web to send data across the internet and get data back. Those layers have a framework that can understand files that describe a deep neural network, mm-hmm. for example. And the operating system takes care of an input that you provide, runs it throughout that complex network. In the end, it's going to have the output for each class and the probability of being that mm-hmm. class. So that layer in the OS then gives that back to the user.
So if I'm very interested in this idea of running locally at the device for good privacy reasons, mm-hmm. you can do skin cancer classification, and the image doesn't have to leave my phone.
That's right.
As long as I trust it's not going on some way in the background, it gives me a level of comfort with it.
Right.
But that means the model was deployed to my device.
That's correct.
So from the perspective of the person who invested resources in building the model,
yes.
maybe they have some concern an end user could steal it or something along these lines.
That's true.
How does one address or make considerations like that?
Yeah, that is a good question. I don't have a good answer, mm-hmm. to be honest, on how to protect once it leaves. It's like an image. If you pass that image to someone, to another developer,
yeah.
they can consume that image and then use it in any device. I would look at it no different than any other resource.
Let the lawyers figure it out.
Developer.
Yeah,
everything you put there, it's my property.
Yeah, you could decompile anything you want.
You can decompile and go steal like the image assets and things in there. So I don't think it's a new problem. One thing that it's not about stealing now, but it's mm-hmm. about how can you evolve that model? That's a good, interesting question as well. Because mm-hmm. once you bundle that model with your app, and the app is in the wild. Let's say this is IoT, an IoT scenario. Mm-hmm. And now this is in sensors in 1,000 different...
Right, deployed all over.
Deployed all over. And then you want to iterate on that model and create a new one. How do you make sure that all those devices get the latest and greatest?
Yeah, good question.
So in that scenario, there are many ways to go about it. If you use some of the IoT technologies that we use to manage apps, you could manage it that way. So the devices they have, be able to talk to, so they can't be completely offline. They need to be able to talk to a centralized location to get the latest bits. So that is one way to evolve them. Another one is if you have a mobile app, there is no difference there between, again, like that AI model and any other resource. So that story of how to evolve those models, it would work well if those devices are connected and they can still reach out to the cloud and get binaries and in the latest version of things.
So lastly, you've been building a lot of these demos to show how a software engineer who doesn't necessarily know a lot about machine learning can bring these products to market.
Yeah.
Is there any one particular service or area you think has been underutilized and maybe we'll see some very interesting things emerging in the months and years to come?
I'd like to see more of the Bing services being used more. Like, a lot of folks don't know, but when you go to Bing and search for things, almost everything that you get, all the insights you get back.
The pages, the pages, people, the metadata.
The people, the visual tags. If it is like a picture of a landmark, if it is like a picture of a celebrity, if it has products. They have APIs that also can let developers surface those type of insights in your own app. And I don't see a lot of that, at least personally. Maybe they are being used, but I don't see that. Things like the face API and computer vision, those are more obvious because it's a very custom and more complex scenario, like face recognition and things like that. But when it comes to web searches, there is, I think, a lot of potential there for app developers to tap into, like, what is the latest on the internet.
Yeah.
And then create experiences around that. And I mentioned like insights about searches that we do, like in terms of images and people and so on. They also have data about news, for example. Let's say you have an application and the application is about, I don't know, hiking. You don't need to stop at having a list of hikes in an area and so on. You could, for example, use Bing News to find news related to that topic. Or images that have been tagged related to that thing and then surface some intelligence in the app just from the web data because there's so much data out there. And so I think that is an area that maybe with time, with developers creating richer and richer apps, I think you might start seeing more of these suggestions and content that otherwise you wouldn't think about seeing there because first, even if they had access to like knowledge for AI, having the data to put it there is very hard. Like, how can you get news data from the last 5 minutes unless go to a source like that?
Yeah.
And that is where the Bing APIs can provide that.
Very neat. Yeah, I think that's planted some seeds with me for sure. So I appreciate that.
Yeah, sure.
Well, Carlos, thank you so much for coming on and sharing all your expertise today.
You're welcome.
Data Skeptic is a listener-supported program. To support the show, visit dataskeptic.com and click on the membership tab.